So we're here at Tonto Bridge Park here in Arizona.
We're going to see what is growing naturally here at Tonto's Bridge. Of course, there's a, grassy grasslands and fields that's manicured and maintained by the parks. But here's a stream. You know, we are in a valley here. Cuts through it, and we could go down in the stream and take a look at what's growing naturally. So you can see all this mint here is growing. And, you know, things that grow in nature are a lot healthier for us to eat because they have to be naturally bug resistant. So here's some mint right here, and if you were here to smell this mint, this is really strong mint. So mint actually will take over your garden, so you want to contain it in raised beds. Next to it here, if you look very closely, here's some dandelion growing. So this is baby dandelion greens, really delicious to grow and to eat. And as you can see, you know, there's barely any bug damage to these plants because these plants grow in nature. You know, if you're growing the weeds and things like this that grow in nature, you know, there's no pesticides in nature except the ones that the plants naturally make to deter the insects from eating them. So let's take a look. Here's another really cool one. I've actually never seen it growing before in my life. And down over here, what we have growing literally in the stream, right next to the stream, is all this beautiful watercress. And you know, so if you grow hydroponically, because this watercress is, you know, obviously it's watercress, grown in water, and here's a whole plant. You know, we could take this watercress plant now and we could take it and give it a new home in our home, you know, growing hydroponically. And of course, you know, there are definitely some bugs here, but you know, wash off this watercress, and this watercress is much more strong than the stuff, you know, the mild stuff we get in the store, because this stuff has to be strong because it's living in nature and it doesn't want bugs and things to eat it. And I mean, it just grows in water. So if you have really wet and moist soils, you know, watercress is your baby. That's what you should be growing. And this stuff is absolutely delicious.
So we're on our way to Tonto Bridge. It's up over there. You can see the waterfall, if you look closely, running down right through the center of it. It's going to be really exciting. We're going to go in there, and I'm going to hike around a little bit, and we're going to answer your questions and answers today underneath Tonto Bridge here in Arizona.
So we're here under Tonto's Bridge. And basically, it's open on both sides. There's one side, and we could pan around to the top. It's almost like perpetually raining in here. The water just drips through the ceiling, and then just down, you can see, like, the water hitting the little pool down there. And it's open on the other side. So I'm just going to finish my hike. Then what we're going to do is we're going to hike down there, and we're going to answer some of your questions today.
So we're back. We're here in Tonto's Bridge here in Arizona. And you can see, I mean, just in this cavern, you might be able to hear the echo in my voice. And today we're going to do the questions and answers underneath Tonto's Bridge, since I don't want to leave you guys hanging and have a video for you, even though I'm traveling and not at my garden. Hopefully you enjoyed the wild foods growing just above Tonto's Bridge. But now we're going to take your questions. So Ernest302 asks, hey, I got a question for you. I live in a 20-foot camper on my son's property. I'm unemployed and on food stamps, and to get food from the food bank, basically homeless. I want to grow things in my camper that I can add to the food I make to make it better. I want to be independent in my camper. I've enjoyed your videos all summer, but I want to stay mobile at a second's notice, so I can't do a garden here. But what are some things I can do now during the fall, winter months, and next spring? So definitely in a camper you could grow your own food, definitely cool. Check the videos I made at Got Sprouts. They showed how to grow wheatgrass sprouts. Besides, I wouldn't necessarily recommend wheatgrass sprouts for you, but what you could easily grow is the sunflower greens. Basically, it's the same exact way you would grow the wheatgrass sprouts, but use the black oil sunflower seeds. It's often sold as bird seed. So go to your local Lowe's store, buy a big 20-pound bag of bird seed, black oil seed. Of course, if you do want to get organic, you could do an online search. Much more expensive to get the black oil seed organic than to get it, you know, as the bird seed. The bird seed generally sprouts pretty good, make some good sprouts. Also pea greens, you could sprout peas and get pea greens, and also the buckwheat sprouts you could grow indoors. Wraith99 asks, I'm sure you are busy, but I hope you can take some time to answer my questions. I am starting my own raised beds. They are 2 feet wide and 8 feet long. I use green Douglas fir that is 2x12x8 inches dimensions to make the beds. My main question is it okay to use 100% compost, or should I mix it with some other dirt? So my first comment is, I would encourage you to make, unless you're against the fence, to make your beds 4 feet, basically wide by 8 feet long. That way, if you're on either side of it, you can reach in 2 feet, and you're basically going to get a lot more square footage to plant in than just 2 feet. It's basically doubling your space. Basically, what I do is I use 100% organic compost from Sonoma Compost, their Mallard Plus Mix Plus rock dust minerals. It's very important to add the rock dust minerals. So that's what I personally use. Should I recommend that you do that too? You know, well, it depends on your climate and the compost you're getting. I've seen in some parts of the country where the compost that they give away from the city or even from places are just not a good, rich, finished compost, and they may be lacking in some nutrients because not all composts are, you know, created equal. So you want to definitely get, you know, go to a garden center or maybe your Lowe's, get Mel's mix, you know, go to the garden center and look for some good organic things and mix a couple things in, as well as, you know, a good layer of compost in the bottom if you're not going to use all compost. And once again, it's like trial and error. I know what works in my area, and you guys got to figure out what works in your area. Maybe you could visit, you know, local garden centers, ask what's them the best thing. I wouldn't necessarily trust the employees at Home Depot or Lowe's or anything like that. But a good garden center, if you have a university extension office in your area that basically teaches about growing foods, or actually also check with your local farmers and ask them what they're doing. I mean, definitely you want to use a good percentage of compost or regular topsoil. Blend it up with compost. Depending if you live in a drier climate, you might want to add vermiculite, which actually retains some water. And that's actually what's in Mel's mix, and that's available at Lowe's. But that stuff can get very expensive. So I encourage everybody to buy in bulk. And you know what? Fill it up with whatever you can and start growing. And if it doesn't work so good, well, then you need to do soil tests. And I'll have another episode on that to find out how you can balance out the soil if it's not the optimal soil for you. And you're only going to know by basically knowing, or by taking the soil and sending it off to labs, or getting a simple test kit, you know, at your local nursery to basically do an NPK test, which is some basic test for some basic nutrition. And you want to make sure to add the rock dust minerals. That's very important to any raised bed or any garden and any plants that you're even growing in containers. And I'll be soon having an episode, a really good episode with my friend Don Weaver on rock dust. So stay tuned for that. So Creative Evil Genius asks, and you know, I wonder how people come up with these cool names. I was wondering if you have done any videos yet or more north/midwest climate zones like Wisconsin. All right, yo, what's up Wisconsin? Or if you plan on doing anything. I'm going to start hitting the research hard pretty quick here. My girlfriend and I just bought a house, and it's my goal to gear up for gardening through the winter and hit it really hard as soon as I can and start planting in the spring. Awesome. Well, that's great. My research has mainly been related to California and also, you know, desert gardening like in Las Vegas and those areas. Those are the areas that I'm currently most interested in. If you want to pay for my plane ticket out to your area, love to work with you and do that and find out what's growing in your area. But you know what? What I do isn't like rocket science. I go around and I try to see what grows in my area. So what I've been doing is doing research. I've been sharing those videos with you guys, and I go around to places, you know, farms, orchards, you know, and whatnot, to film what they're growing at different times to see what's doing good and what's not doing so good. So for you, you want to probably contact your local extension office, go to your local farmers markets, talk with local farmers in your area that are already growing things, and simply ask them, hey, what are you growing right now? What are you starting right now? How do you do it? You know, hey, can I intern on your farm or your garden to learn from you? And you know, I'm sure they would love extra work. I always have extra weeds to pull, so if anybody wants to help me out pulling weeds and doing things around my garden, let me know to intern with me. But you know, find somebody in your area that's already growing and growing successfully and offer just to give them help for free. And that way you'll help them and you'll also learn their craft. And that's really important. We all need to learn from each other and what we're doing in your specific climate zone. I mean, I can show you what works in my climate zone, and some of that may be applicable to your climate zone, but it's not always the case. So, you know, get with a local farmer that's growing in your area, and worst case, you know, just start to try to grow yourself, see what happens, make videos, document it, and share with others so that they can learn from your mistakes and from your successes, more importantly. All right, so Zionist Mom asks, I'm doing a very small raised garden for the first year this first time. I would like to try a bigger one this spring and would like to do the raised beds like yours. Silly question for you, do your raised bed have wooden bottoms or do they just sit on the soil? That's a very excellent question. There's no such thing as a silly question. So my raised beds are just basically open to the soil. And you know, there's pros and cons of each way. So So if you're building a raised bed like I had a couple of episodes ago on the video with the juniper wood, you know, they basically built raised beds like on a table, a raised bed table, and there's no bed. Basically, that's more like a planter box. So in some conditions, you might want to put a bottom on your raised bed. Say, for example, you live in the middle of New York City or in Harlem or something, and they used your space as like a drug and garbage dumping ground. There's all kinds of contaminants in the soil. Then you might want to close it off to the bottom. But in most cases, I would urge people to, you know, leave it open to the bottom. And how I do it is I build the raised bed, and then depending if you have gophers or not, you need to put a wire mesh down for the gophers, protect the roots and underneath of your plants. If you don't have the gophers, like I don't have gophers where I live, I just did what's called cardboard sheet mulching. So I took cardboard, laid it out the entire bottom of the raised bed, and then I just put all the compost and rock dust on top and just planted the plants and put my drip system in. Of course, plan your drip system before you start filling it all up, because that's the first thing that you need to do. And check my old videos to see, actually, Sage putting in my drip or, water piping before we even built the raised beds. All right, last question for today is from You Are All Dumb and Blind. All right, I don't think I'm dumb and blind, but anyways, I know you would be the guy to ask, and I'm sure you would make a kick-ass hot video on the best way to make a winter garden. And, you know, I'm going to have a winter garden I'll show you guys, too, when that's time. I'm still harvesting summer crops right now, or I have people harvesting my summer crops for me right now since I'm away. Now the winter garden isn't for food, well, sort of. It's more to make a seed factory for the best of the best from the winter garden. Is that possible? What would one need? How would you go about it? I've ordered these heirloom seeds, tomatoes and peppers, and I would like to grow them in the winter and harvest the seeds for springtime. Well, you know what? That's an excellent idea, but the problem with that is a lot of the summer vegetables don't grow in the wintertime or in the cold. You might be able to get away with it doing inside, but it would be really too complicated and too difficult to do that, so I don't recommend growing anything kind of like summer crops in the wintertime for their seed production. That would be really cool if you could do that. And in places like Hawaii and tropical Florida, you know, and where it stays warmer, you might actually be able to do that. But in most of the U.S., you can't grow summer crops and harvest the seeds, and then for the spring, you want to just order your seeds or save your springs from this, you know, season for next year in the summertime. Or you could order your seeds, you know, fresh, you know, maybe early next year, order your seeds fresh for the springtime to plant out. That being said, you can grow in the wintertime, and you should grow a winter garden. And in the wintertime, most of the things that grow are like the leafy greens, things like chard and kale and collards and lettuce, depending on your climate zone, can grow really well. One of the things I really like to grow for the seeds in the winter time that I can't really grow in the summer because it gets too hot is chickweed. Grow chickweed. They're a seed factory, man. The chickweed will make millions this season. I have an episode on saving chickweed seeds during the winter time. Save all your seeds, and then you're going to use those next winter. So we have to operate in the seasons that nature provides. You know, I would love to grow tomatoes year-round, and one day I will in a tropical location. But until then, you know, focus on making seed factories for the seeds for that season. So if you're in the summertime, you're going to grow tomatoes and peppers and save the seeds from that season for the following year. And for winter, then you're going to grow plants in the winter that grow well in the winter, you know, like the kale and collards and all the brassicas, cauliflower, broccoli, and, you know, the chickweed and other things, and even violas. I grow violas in the winter and save the seeds from those. Those are amazing. And save the seeds from those for the next winter. And that's how we should do it. A good resource for buying seeds, if you don't know about them, is Seed Savers of America. You can do a search on that. Make sure you join Seed Savers of America. You know, this is the way we all need to save our seeds, is actually each person saving our seeds, coming up into a collective like Seed Savers, where members like me and thousands of other people across the United States grow their certain things. They save their seeds. They put it in the Seed Savers of America catalog to share with other people, because you know what? Big businesses are not going to be saving the seeds for us. They want to monopolize the seed market, give us the GMO seeds that have the Terminator genes so they won't reproduce. And we want to save the seeds that have been around in heirloom and growing in nature for thousands and millions of years and spread things amongst ourselves. This is a grassroots phenomenon and grassroots thing that we're going on, and we need to just each support each other, and that's why I do this work that I do. So anyway, I think that's about all the time we have for today. So this is John Kohler from GrowingYourGreens.com coming at you from Tonto's Bridge in beautiful Arizona. Keep on growing, and we'll see you next time.